went over to him and said, "Did you enjoy the talk?" And he said, "Oh yes, couldn't hear a word." A little advertising to start with. My talk today is about one of the most notorious murder cases of the 1920s, exactly 100 years ago, the trial of Major Herbert Rouse Armstrong, an obscure country solicitor charged with murdering his wife at Hay-on-Wye in a small, remote country town on the England and Wales border. The trial attracted not only huge publicity in this country, but around the world, and it has resonances to today. He remains the only solicitor ever to be hanged for murder in England. The reason alone makes him notorious. Tens of thousands of words a day were spent covering his case in the British press, still at that stage the only source of news. But it was also reported across the English-speaking world, across North America and Australia, New Zealand and South Africa. As the Charlotte Observer in far distant North Carolina noted, "The greatest poison drama of the century has this tiny country village as a background. All England is thrilled by the trial of a modern Borgia." Not only that, some clues there, but it was a story which had resonances in the development of a new genre of crime fiction, the hugely popular detective mysteries of writers such as Agatha Christie, Dorothy Sayers, and Anthony Barclay. They were just starting their whodunnit writing careers 100 years ago. Christie had just published The Mysterious Affair at Stiles, the first Poirot, and Sayers was working on Whose Body, the first Lord Peter Wimsey. Both of them were far too clever to copy the Armstrong case wholesale. But the similarities are obvious. Professional rivalry among respectable middle-class folk in a remote location, an isolated community. An unsuspected poisoning detected only by chance. Diabolical cunning, a small slip leading to an ingenious unmasking of the criminal. It's all there. Both Sayers and Christie and other similar novelists knew all about the case. Sayers and Georgette Heyer, in her crime writing career, both referred specifically to it. As George Orwell noted in his essay, The Decline of the English Murder, in 1946, the murderer should be a little man of the professional class, a dentist or a solicitor, say, living an intensely respectable life. He should plan it all with the utmost cunning and only slip up over some tiny, unforeseeable detail. The means chosen should, of course, be poison. And as an example, he chose Major Armstrong. But was it an open and shut case? Did he murder his wife and try to poison the fellow solicitor? The answer is by no means clear cut. He certainly didn't get a fair trial. Exactly 100 years ago this week, Armstrong was sitting in the condemned cell at Gloucester Prison, protesting his innocence and awaiting his fate. So who was he? This is him, Major Herbert Rouse Armstrong, a little short, dapper man with a waxed moustache and piercing blue eyes behind his gold-rimmed pince-nez spectacles, a solicitor of some years' standing. Hay-on-Wye is pretty remote today, as any of you who've been there will know, but it was even more isolated and obscure then. There certainly wasn't an international book festival in those days. Major Armstrong always used his military title, though he had only been a desk waller during the First World War. But he was not only a senior partner in a local solicitor's firm, he was also the clerk to three district magistrates' courts, a regular churchgoer, and a pillar of the Freemasons' Lodge. He'd lived locally in Hay since 1906. He was well liked there, and had done work for many of the local people. And apparently, he was very happily married with three young children. He'd been married to Katharine since 1907. This is a wedding day photograph. They don't look terribly happy, I must say. She was highly strung and rather tense, intellectual, musical. She played the piano and a bit bossy. There was a celebrated incident at a tennis match when she interrupted her husband's match by announcing loudly, "Come along, Herbert, it's time for your bath." He was not allowed to smoke or drink except in one room in the house. And if they went out to dinner, she would tell the waiter, "No wine for the major." Despite this, he was a doting husband, or at least seemed to be. However, after the end of the war, with the family back together, she became fearful, even irrational, and she began to suffer from delusions. She became convinced that she was a bad mother, letting the family down, defrauding tradespeople. She was having a breakdown, and eventually, with her husband, sister, and doctor's agreement, she was committed to an asylum in August 1920. It sounds very much like she was suffering from depression, or melancholia, as it was called then. She was there for 6 months before being released at her husband's request. But when she returned home to Hay-on-Wye in January 1921, there were still delusions, and she rapidly went physically downhill. She became bedridden, could not feed herself, had a nurse in constant attendance, sleeping in the bed next to her. But despite that, within a month, she died. There was no suspicion that her death was anything but natural, and the local GP who'd been treating her, Dr. Hinks, signed the death certificate, and she was buried quickly in the local churchyard. Life resumed. Major Armstrong took a holiday abroad, but when he returned to Hay, he became embroiled in a dispute over an estate sale with the town's other solicitor, a new young arrival in town called Oswald Martin. This is Oswald Martin and his wife Connie, what the well-dressed young solicitor was wearing in 1922, plus fours, a Peaky Blinders cap, and a floppy bow tie. Bit fast, if you ask me. Major Armstrong certainly thought so. A bit of a cad, definitely lower class. He had even turned up for a tea party in a cardigan and an open-necked shirt. Such things were noticed and mattered in the society of Hay. There were lots of land sales after the First World War, and with an agricultural slump in prices, in this case, the value of the farms on the estate went down after the sales were agreed. The sale saw the two local solicitors on opposite sides, Armstrong representing the owner, Martin the tenants, wanting to buy their farms. Prices generally were falling and there was a hassle over the agreed price, and Martin, the pushy young solicitor, became aggressive over the sale. It became acrimonious and the dispute dragged on. Eventually, Armstrong invited Martin to tea at his house one evening in October 1921. That's the Armstrong's house. And this is what it looks like today. Virtually unchanged, as you can see. The tea party took place in the ground floor left-hand study. Armstrong incidentally rented the property for £50 a year, complete with an acre of ground. It was a big lawn and it had lots of dandelions. It was one of the most fateful tea parties in criminal history. It was held in that front room as the autumn evening was drawing in. Things don't change much around Hay, as you can see. Well, Armstrong and Martin chatted in a friendly fashion, and when the maid brought in the tea things, Martin said Armstrong handed him a scone, saying, "Scuse fingers." Was it a poisoned scone? An hour or so later, Martin drove home. He had a substantial supper with his wife, jugged hare and coffee cream to follow. He'd married the local chemist's daughter, Connie, earlier that summer, and later in the evening, he began to feel very sick indeed. This is the local chemist shop run by Connie's father, Fred Davis. Martin was stricken for several days, but then recovered. And it was at about this time that his father-in-law, Fred, remembered that he'd sold Major Armstrong a large amount of arsenic over the years to use on the dandelions in the lawn. Purchasing arsenic from the chemist was perfectly legal in the 1920s. You could buy it by the pound, and all you had to do was sign a poisons register. You bought arsenic to poison vermin, or, like the major, to make weed killer for the garden. Hard to imagine today, a pound of arsenic cost about 2 and 6 pence, maybe the equivalent of £5 today, I suppose. And to give you some idea, a pound is equal in weight to 7,000 grains. And 3 grains is enough to kill you. It's about the same, 3 grains is about the same as half a paracetamol tablet. Incidentally, the shop is still a chemist's shop today, but you can't buy arsenic over the counter anymore. The major had a lot of arsenic. He'd been buying it for years, but he did have a large garden. His method was to dig a little hole by the dandelion root and pour in some arsenic powder. Arsenic is, as you possibly know, a white, colourless powder, looking a bit like sugar or flour. It's tasteless and colourless. That was one of the attractions for poisoners. And the symptoms of poisoning, stomach ache, sickness, vomiting, drowsiness, neuritis, can easily be mistaken for something else until it's too late. This is Fred Davis, the man in the middle, on his way to giving evidence. He was a garrulous, rumour-mongering little chap. He had an interest in the case because he was Martin's father-in-law. And Fred Davis remembered the major's purchases and said to his daughter Connie that they should watch out for unexpected gifts of food. The penny dropped, and she and Oswald remembered that there had been an anonymous box of chocolates delivered only a few weeks before. And then they remembered that Oswald's sister-in-law, on a weekend visit, had tasted a chocolate, and surprise, surprise, she'd been very sick too. They had put the box away, but when they showed it to Fred, close inspection showed a couple of the chocolates had little holes bored into them from which white powder was dripping. They consulted the local doctor, here he is, Tom Hinks, who had treated both Katharine before she died and Oswald when he was ill. He treated them for upset tummies. He had had no suspicions of anything other than that. Well, Dr. Hinks, who'd been a friend of the major for many years, they were masons together, thought about it as he went off on his rounds. He usually travelled on horseback. You can see the gaiters he's wearing. Because some of the outlying farms were incredibly remote. They weren't on metalled roads or even on footpaths. During my research, I spoke to one elderly local gentleman in Hay who reckoned that Dr. Hinks had probably overseen his birth. And he said when his father, who was a farmer on one of those outlying farms, had developed toothache, Dr. Hinks had come and extracted 5 teeth with the use of a pair of pliers. So he was a GP who cared for the community from birth through to death. Maybe the deaths came quicker than might otherwise have done. The more Dr. Hinks thought about it, the more he became convinced that Martin must have been poisoned. Maybe Katharine too. And that Major Armstrong was the only possible poisoner. He'd had the means, arsenic, the motive, getting rid of a troublesome wife and an aggravating, pushy young business rival, and the opportunity, the tea party. Fred Davis was soon telling everyone who came into the shop that Major Armstrong would do away with them all. Hinks wrote off to the Home Office expressing his concerns. The chocolates and Martin's specimen were tested, though a few days after the young solicitor had recovered, and arsenic was found. Only a trace in Martin's case, certainly not enough to kill him. That triggered a police investigation into the Major, and two Scotland Yard detectives were sent down to Hay undercover to gain evidence. They took statements and they lurked covertly in the shrubbery. Not an easy thing for Chief Inspector Alf. Chief Inspector Alf Crutchett, an archetypal Agatha Christie policeman, if ever I saw one. He's the one on the left in the bowler hat, accompanied by his sidekick, Inspector Walter Sharp. As you can see, they were not particularly easy to hide in a small country town where everyone knew everyone else. Astonishingly, there'd been another poisoning case against a Welsh solicitor only a few months before. A man called Harold Greenwood had been acquitted after a sloppy police investigation, and the authorities were determined that it wouldn't happen again. He'd got away with apparently poisoning his wife. To lose one case might be a misfortune. To lose two might seem very much like carelessness. So they were thorough. The top toxicologist, Dr. John Webster, and Sir William Wilcox, and the top pathologist of the day, Bernard Spilsbury, were called in. But there was very little hard evidence to go on. Nevertheless, within weeks, on New Year's Eve, Saturday, the 31st of December, 1921, Herbert Armstrong had breakfast at home with his three children and walked to his office in Hay. He was wearing his gardening clothes because he expected to be home by lunchtime. Instead, the Scotland Yard men and the Deputy Chief Constable of Herefordshire tramped into the office shortly after his arrival and arrested him for the attempted murder of Oswald Martin. Ambushed and astonished, Armstrong gave a statement protesting his innocence. After all, he'd just seen Martin, hale and hearty, going into his office across the road. But as the police searched the office, a little sachet of arsenic fell out of the Major's pocket and from his gardening coat. It was a lethal amount, overlooked from poisoning the dandelions, perhaps, or intended for another go at Oswald Martin. He'd been inviting Oswald Martin to tea for weeks beforehand, tea in their office in the afternoons, and the young solicitor was getting increasingly paranoid. He was covering up with excuses to avoid going to tea again with the Major. Armstrong was taken into custody, placed in a cell next to his own magistrate's court. He would never see his home or his three children ever again. This is him sitting in the dock of the magistrate's court. As you can see, it's more like a back room than a courtroom. Within days, he was sitting in that dock in his own courtroom in front of a bench of magistrates who he had known for years and regarded as friends. Being accused of trying to poison his professional rival was enough to get the press scurrying to Hay-on-Wye. It was becoming increasingly like a detective story. But then Katharine's body was exhumed from the snowy graveyard, and Spilsbury, here he is, the leading pathologist of the day, carried out a post-mortem by the light of a hurricane lamp on the table of a nearby empty cottage. And what was found were traces of arsenic in her organs, quite enough to kill Mrs. Armstrong 11 months earlier. Spilsbury was the most famous pathologist of his day, and if he was called in for a murder investigation, suspects knew their chances of getting away with anything were fairly slim. You can see a fairly remorseless expression on his face. He was used to exhuming bodies and body parts, unfortunately had lost his sense of smell by this stage. The charge against Armstrong was now increased to murder, a case that would be tried at a higher court, the Assizes, in Hereford. That didn't stop the press reporting every detail of the committal proceedings, as they were allowed to do, including insinuations which were quite speculative and would later be dropped. There was no evidence that the poisoned chocolates, for instance, came from Armstrong, but every newspaper reader in the country heard all about them, and they all added to the picture of a ruthless, terrifying, and sinister killer. And this is the man he was up against. The case was hurried into a special assize court within weeks, at the start of April 1922. The trial took place in front of the hanging judge, Mr. Justice Darling, who was avid to try the case before his retirement a few months later, and had clearly made up his mind from the start that Armstrong was guilty. He wasn't going to miss this. Darling, the story of Darling being asked by a woman whether she could call him Darling or whether he would be preferred to be called Mr. Justice Darling, shades of Blackadder, is unfortunately untrue. Armstrong was defended by one of the best-known barristers in the country, Sir Henry Curtis Bennett, but time and again he was frustrated by the judge's hostile interventions. And when Armstrong went into the box, Darling more or less took over the prosecution, asking again and again why he had had arsenic in his pocket when he was arrested. The Manchester Guardian's reporter said the judge rattled questions at him like a machine gun. This is a photograph of him giving evidence in the trial. You can see the judge in the background busily writing notes. Sir Henry Curtis Bennett, the defence barrister, is the plump-looking gentleman in front of Armstrong. The judge belittled the defence's medical experts and cut off their answers, but praised Spilsbury and the prosecution witnesses. In summing up, he more or less dismissed Armstrong's case altogether. In the circumstances, therefore, it was not surprising that it took the jury only 48 minutes to find the major guilty, and that included a break for them to have a cup of tea. Less than an hour to deliberate on a man's life. And this is a press photograph of Major being led to the taxi that was going to take him down to Gloucester Prison after his conviction. It was said he was weeping, but you can see he's still fairly dapper. They didn't have many police cars in those days, so they hired a taxi to take him with a policeman to sit beside him. This would be his last journey back to prison. There was an appeal, but that was never likely to succeed, and Armstrong went to the gallows on the 31st of May 1922, about 6 weeks after the trial, protesting his innocence. Apparently, the deputy governor of the prison, who knew him from old times, said to him one day, "I don't really like this hanging business, Armstrong," to which the major replied, "No, it must be very painful for you." On his last morning, Armstrong was allowed to change out of his prison uniform and put on his own suit, as was customary. He apparently asked where his shirt collar was and then realised, "Oh, I quite understand." As the hangman pulled the lever on the trapdoor, he claimed to hear Major Armstrong call out, "I'm coming, Kate." At the time, there were very few people who thought the Major was innocent, but doubts about the case have grown over the years. What was his motive for killing his wife, to whom he appeared so devoted? She was in a highly nervous state. She had had a breakdown and just spent 6 months in an asylum being treated for depression. She had spoken about suicide. She knew her husband had arsenic in the house and she could have accessed it. Did she do so? The medical evidence of the experts was also seriously flawed. They told the court that she must have taken the lethal dose only a few hours before her death when she was unable to move. Therefore, it must have been administered to her. But it's now known, as it was speculated then, that victims can survive for days after taking a lethal dose of arsenic. Was the Oswald case a red herring? The medicines he had been taking to deal with his tummy pains themselves contained traces of arsenic, and he'd had a large evening meal when he got home, which he could not have done if he was already feeling sick. The box of poisoned chocolates, which started the whole investigation off, were never linked to Armstrong at the trial. Their existence had been fully aired at the committal, so everyone knew about them, and they were effectively part of the background to the prosecution case. Every newspaper reader knew all about the poisoned chocolates. And there's even the possibility that they were planted by Fred Davis, the chemist. He was the one who sold Armstrong the arsenic. He was the one who first suggested Oswald had been poisoned. He was the one who first suggested raising the matter with the Home Office. And he was a man who had a grudge against Armstrong because the major had helped a rival chemist to set up shop in the town. These were all matters which didn't get raised at the trial. It seems such a simple, open and shut case, a simple slip by a cunning murderer, the scone at tea time, setting off a whole trail of clues and coincidences leading remorselessly and inexorably to the gallows. Now, let me say a little bit about writing the book. Most of my research had to be done online and through books during lockdown, but a window of opportunity opened when restrictions were lifted in the middle of May, 2 weeks before my deadline. And I was able to rush down to Hay and to the National Archives in London to do some original research. This is Major Armstrong's office. It's still a solicitor's firm. And his desk and his chair are still in situ in his office where he was arrested, which is on the first floor on the left. Indeed, the brass plate has been polished up and is still on the wall in the reception area. You can still look out of that first floor window at the rival solicitor's office directly across the street, which indeed is still a solicitor's office. Better still, the Hereford firm of the solicitor who represented Armstrong, Tom Matthews, still has five boxes of material from the case: letters, witness statements, press cuttings, accounts, and other documents, and I was allowed to go through them. I was sitting in a conference room, and on the wall above me, framed, was Major Armstrong's last letter to the lawyer, written on prison notepaper on his last afternoon. "My dear Matthews, no one could have done more or worked more loyally and with more devotion to duty. Soldierly to the last, stiff upper lip." The frame also includes the Major's pipe, which he gave to the solicitor as a memento of his last visit. In the book, I also go into what happened to the three Armstrong children, which is a very tragic and poignant story in itself. This is them in happier, more prosperous times. And this is them in the care of the housekeeper, Emily Pierce, on the right, and the housemaid on the left. Probably a press photograph, and it looks as if it was probably taken after the major's execution. They were fostered out separately. Catherine's sister didn't want anything to do with them, really. And in the case of the youngest, Margaret, who was only five, she was not told what had happened to her parents. All references to her father were obliterated. She had no photographs, no letters, even the page of her christening Bible, which the major had written in, was ripped out. Said that she only found out the truth when she was taken to Madame Tussaud's on a school trip as a teenager and came face to face with her father's effigy in the Chamber of Horrors. Imagine a lifetime of denial, of telling your own children that their grandmother had died of a stomach complaint and their grandfather had died falling off scaffolding. Margaret only died in 2004, but only spoke publicly about what had happened in the last few years of her life. So finally, did Armstrong do it? Well, he certainly didn't get a fair trial. That's certainly what I thought for much of the time when I was writing the book. He certainly shouldn't have been convicted on the evidence submitted. But was he innocent? Then, towards the end of my researches, I was pointed to a previously unheard witness, a lawyer himself, who had a painful encounter with at one of the major's last dinner parties. There was talk of a poisoned cigarette. It's an intriguing possibility, and it's in my book, The Poisonous Solicitor. Of course, there's a lot more in the book than I've had time to go into here, including the Major's mysterious girlfriend. It's a rich slice, I think, of 1920s noir, a very different time in social attitudes and social class, attitudes that are sometimes hard to fathom, and yet it's almost within living memory. Thank you very much for listening to me. Are there any questions?
Any questions from anyone?
Stunned into silence.
Thank you so much. I really enjoyed that talk. Apologies for being a few minutes late. I just wanted to know, and I'm sorry if I missed it at the beginning, how famous in local zeitgeist and national zeitgeist was this if he was represented in Madame Tussauds, and how long much later was that? Was his child fully grown when she saw?
Well, it's alleged that she was in her teens, so at least 10 years. It was a very famous case in its day. People like Edgar Wallace covered the story, and as I say, it was reported across the world, as well as in enormous detail in the British press. Thousands and thousands of words. The Guardian today, my old paper, would cover a sensational murder trial on a day-by-day basis with perhaps 800 or 1,000 words. The Manchester Guardian covered this particular trial in a remote corner of England, 8,000 words a day. I mean, newspapers were illustrated, there were photographs, but there were long columns of grey, detailed type, almost verbatim. The local Hereford Times published a special supplement every evening, 8 pages, all very closely typed. So it must have been 10 or 15,000 words a night, and it was on sale for a penny by 4 o'clock in the afternoon. So they really put in an effort. You wouldn't find that today, I think.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed that, and I've got the book.
Oh, good.
What are the alternatives? If it was not murder, then what was it? Was it an accident? Was it, or was there anyone else who actually committed the crime? So what are the options if he did not commit murder? What are the other possibilities?
Well, the defense at his trial argued strongly that Katharine must have administered the poison herself. Really, there was no one else apart from the nurse who attended her in the last few weeks. And she certainly never came under suspicion and was not likely to have had any motive. There were signs that Katharine was a bit suicidal. She'd spoken to the nurse and said, would I die if I threw myself out of an upper window? This was rather dismissed because it was held that someone was unlikely to ask that question if they were suicidal. So the judge very firmly squashed any suggestion of suicide, which of course was a criminal offense in those days. And implied that Katharine was of spotless character and was certainly an innocent victim. And it is quite hard to know if she didn't administer it herself by design or accident, who else would have done so apart from the major, who was the only other person who had access to her. And that was very clearly the prosecution case at the trial.
What about the others?
It was, well, the supposition at the trial was that he had been poisoned by Armstrong over their legal dispute. It really isn't very clear whether he had any arsenic at all, apart from the bismuth he was taking to clear up his chippy tummy, which did have arsenic in it in those days. And the amount of arsenic in his body, in his urine when it was tested some days after the event in a rather dirty bottle, was very small. So it was a very marginal consideration whether he had actually been poisoned or not. But it was very useful to the prosecution to suggest there was method in Armstrong trying out poisoning on various different people. Martin was a rather sad case. He was rather driven out of Hay after this. Most people had liked the major and were not at all so sure that he was guilty. And Martin went and set up his business about as far away as possible in Great Yarmouth and died early as well.
Mr. Bates, thank you very much indeed. Was there another possible motive in that I seem to remember reading there was a lot of talk at the time, I'm not sure how much evidence there was, that Major Armstrong had very much what one could call a roving eye. And I seem to remember that there were stories about a Madame X, who was never identified, who seemed to appear in his life after the death of his wife. Were there sort of issues like that that might have been a motive?
They might well have been a motive. Madame X was actually a woman called Marion Gale, who he was certainly seeing both before and after his wife died. There was absolutely no proof of any impropriety in those days, though the prosecution liked to suggest that there was. The major was being treated by Dr. Hinks for suspected syphilis, and this was also deployed by the prosecution as an implication that he was a louche character. It's by no means sure that he was suffering from syphilis. He'd been tested by specialist doctors in Birmingham who decided he didn't have a venereal disease, and indeed the prison doctor at Gloucester said there was no evidence. But the major certainly thought he might have it, and Dr. Hinks, who was suggestible in these things, obviously thought that it revealed an immoral character.
Thank you very much. Fascinating talk. I wonder how much popular opinion had to bear on how cases like this came out and what the verdict was in the end. A case that I've had to do with in terms of memorialising is that of Edith Thompson and Freddie Bywaters, who were hanged in 1923. And much of that, the popular presentation of that was presenting Edith Thompson as an immoral woman because she was having an affair. And her conviction became almost inevitable because of the way she was portrayed. Although, in fact, I think it was extremely unjust. But how much does popular opinion have to do with how murder trials came out in the 1920s?
Very much, and certainly the Thompson-Bywaters case was only a few months later. And indeed, Curtis Bennett, Armstrong's barrister, also defended Edith Thompson. Small cadre of lawyers went round the country together trying, prosecuting, defending murder trials, and they came up regularly against judges like Darling, who were certainly not afraid to sentence people to death, even on fairly murky evidence. There was a lot of prejudice against the major. I found that the press coverage was pretty verbatim. There was some prejudice. Prejudice was allowed much more freely in those days. As I say, the committal proceedings were reported much more fully than they would be today. And certainly, as I say, the poisoned chocolates were held very much as part of the evidence against him, although they played no part in the trial because they couldn't prove that he'd had anything to do with it. Martin and his wife had received the anonymous box of chocolates but had thrown away the address label and the wrapping, so there's no way of saying where they or who'd sent them. It was known where they were sold, but the major hadn't been anywhere near that place. So it was a red herring, and even the judge decided that it shouldn't feature in the trial. On the other hand, he did allow the evidence about Martin to feature in the trial as evidence of system, as they say. If Armstrong had poisoned his wife, it was likely that he'd also poisoned Martin. The defense strenuously objected to that, but Mr. Justice Darling said, well, if I'm wrong, the Court of Appeal will overturn my judgment in this. Darling knew full well, having sat on the Court of Appeal, that in those days the Court of Appeal just didn't overturn verdicts in court because they thought that would seriously undermine the police and the judiciary. So although it did go to appeal, there was virtually no chance of the conviction being overturned.
Well, Stephen, thank you so much for such a fascinating talk. You've given us just enough of a glimpse to want to read the full book and get the full story. You've done such meticulous research. So do, if you haven't already purchased it, buy it outside and join us for a glass of wine. And before that, let's offer another hand to Stephen. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.